Making your calling and election sure. It's a four-week series on 2 Peter. If you were coming on Wednesday nights back in the fall, we did a study on 1 Peter. Now we're in 2 Peter. Okay? I'll be teaching with my criminal co-conspirator, Jim Miller. We'll be teaching the next four Wednesday nights together. Next week we might do a little debate. Who knows? We'll try to keep it interesting, but we're going to study the Word of God. Okay? And I just encourage you to come each Wednesday night. We'll give you a credit in our recently accredited university. We just got online all kinds of... You'll see. It's pretty exciting. For us. To begin with, let's read the Word of God. 2 Peter, the first chapter. Tonight we're going to study the first 11 verses. 2 Peter comes right there after 1 Peter, towards the end of the Bible, before concordance. There you go. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make effort to add to your faith goodness, and to your goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he is nearsighted and blind, and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word this night. And Lord, we pray in Jesus' name that you will bring your word to light as we study together. Let your Holy Spirit come, teaching us, directing us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, my first duty tonight is to give you a little background on the book of 2 Peter. Okay? When I was a kid, back a couple centuries ago, we had to learn to write, they call them current events, and we had to answer the W questions, you know, who, what, where, when, why, and how. And if you brought up that how started with an H, you got your wrist slapped, so you just didn't mention it. This was a long time ago. So I'm going to answer those questions a couple times today, because after Jim teaches for a while, I'm going to come back and do the teaching from the end of the last verses we read. So what are we studying? We're studying the second epistle of Peter. It's a letter. A letter that he wrote, and he addressed it to all the elect scattered about. Who wrote it? Well, it's funny that there's any controversy about this, but there was controversy about this from the very beginning, just about. Some people didn't think Peter wrote it. Okay? Now, you got the internal witness. It says, Peter. Not only that, it says, Simon Peter, right? Wrote it. But I suppose somebody could have forged his name. It mentions that he's an apostle. And in verses chapter 1, verses 16 through 18, it mentions that he was present at the transfiguration. You know, that's the time that Jesus took three of his disciples, Peter, James, and John, up on a mountaintop, and they saw Moses and Elijah, and Jesus say, "Hi, guys, good to see you." They walked by and they waved. I assume they were waving at me since you can't see them. Sorry for the distraction. Moses and Elijah and Jesus were talking, and Peter said, "Ah, it's good we're here. I'll build you a little hut." And he didn't know what he was saying, but he mentions that. He mentions that he was there at the Transfiguration. He mentions that he was a peer with the Apostle Paul. Not many guys could say that. And he also says, "This is the second letter I've written to you." And nobody questions that he wrote the first one. They just question that he wrote the second one. Don't ask me why. Okay. Secondly, he says in verse 21 of chapter 1 that he writes, not as if it's himself, he's being moved by the Holy Spirit, which all the scriptures were written that way. Men moved by the Holy Spirit wrote what the Lord was saying to them. Okay, and this letter was known about by the earliest, we call them the church fathers. After the apostles were all dead in the second century, the leaders of the church, they had weird sounding names. And many of them mentioned this letter and said it was written by Simon Peter. Okay, in the two epistles, he has the same views. He talks about the Lord coming suddenly, and he talks about the end of the world. He talks about the prophets. He talks about being born again, or the new birth, by the word of God. And one of the reasons he's writing in both books is to avoid the snares of this world. And there's striking similarities in the way the two letters are worded at times. Plus, both the two letters refer to the flood, Noah's flood, and they mention that there were eight. Each of the two letters, 1 Peter, which everybody says is by Peter, and 2 Peter, which says it's by Simon Peter, but, you know, some people doubt, mention that there were eight people saved in the flood. Well, they actually were saved from the flood in the ark, but don't get technical, Gary. It's good to see you, though. You walked out when you saw it was me teaching, and I said, Gary's back. All right, I love you, brother. Good to see you. So they both mentioned that. There's similarities besides that. There's similarities between this book, 2 Peter, and Peter's sermons and speeches in the book of Acts, where somebody wrote down what Peter said. He talked a lot like the guy that wrote this book. That's kind of interesting. Sounds like, the style sounds like Peter. You know, Peter was kind of a compulsive guy. He was rough and uncultured. He wasn't Paul. You know, he was a fisherman. He was the one that, you know, had a sword. He actually drew out his sword when Jesus was arrested and chopped off a guy's ear. Okay? He wasn't the highly educated guy. Hi, good to see you, girls. The boys walked by a while ago. Now it's the girls. I don't know what's going on. It's good, though. The difference of style between the two books is why some people say it's not written by the same guy. And they are different in style, but it makes sense because, you know, one was written a couple years or later than the other. And also, the purpose is different. So, we believe, I think Jim and I agree on this one, that Peter wrote this book. And I'm sure you guys do, too. It's just a lot of those highly educated idiots that come up with reasons why it's not by Peter. Now, how did Peter write it? All right, how did Peter write it? Well, Peter didn't write Greek, and the book's written in Greek. In fact, that's one of the reasons they say that it's not written by the same guy, because the Greek in 1 Peter is much better than the Greek in 2 Peter. Okay? So they said, and Peter didn't write Greek, so, or at least that's the assumption everybody makes. I don't know if they taught him that on the fishing boats, but I think it's a safe assumption. So I believe he wrote with a translator. Told him what to write, and he wrote it in Greek. And in fact, that's why some of the early fathers said that, yeah, you guys think that this was written by a different writer, but I think that he just had a different translator for the second letter than he had for the first letter. Isn't that interesting? When did he write it? Well, he wrote it after Paul's epistles were all written. Chances are, because in the end of 2 Peter, he says, you know, some things in Paul's epistles are a little confusing. Okay? But they're written by the Holy Spirit, like all Scripture. He calls Paul's epistles Scripture. Okay? And that should have been enough for everybody. If Paul said it was Scripture and Peter said it was Scripture, who's going to argue with him? Amen? Amen. All right. So that would be about 68 or 69 A.D., okay? We're thinking about a year after the first. Now, one commentator, Schofield, says it was probably written in 66, okay? So in the second half of the 60s, you know, with all the rioting and stuff. No, that was in A.D. 60, the first century, okay? Well, Peter was still alive, obviously. They believe it was written before Jerusalem was destroyed. We know Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 A.D. You know, Peter seems to think that something's happening imminently in this Bible, in this book, as he warns about it. So we figure a year or two before the destruction of the temple in 70 A.D. Where was it written? Well, it probably wasn't written in Rome, because then there would be no dispute about, you know, who wrote it. If Peter was in Rome writing it and the Roman church decided which books were written by Peter, it'd be, you know, it'd be pretty obvious. So it probably wasn't written in Rome, and people think it was written in Babylon. I think that's in southern Indiana. I'm not sure. No, it's in Iraq. Why did Peter write this book? Well, most importantly, he wanted to guard his readers against false teachers. There were false teachers starting to come around, teaching, you know, they just stretched the truth a little bit or maybe a lot, and they were teaching lies. And he had to warn them that, watch out for false teachers, they'll lead you astray. It's still a problem today. There's nothing new under the sun. And also, he wanted to exhort them all to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. So that's the background for the writing of the second letter of Peter. And Jim's going to come up and teach on the Scripture. Is this your Bible, or is this left over from Sunday? Oh, really? Okay. Pastor Dave must have another one he takes home.
Okay, well, I am going to start by, I'm going to do two things. I'm going to start getting into the text itself. I'm going to go through verses 1 through 4. And I'm also going to talk a little bit, give an introduction to the false teaching that Peter is addressing here. And let's just start out with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. I just pray you'll be with us as we actually get into the text here and talk about what your word says, Lord. Just give us guidance, give us enlightenment, and we just want to give all the glory and honor to you with this and pray it in your name. Amen. Okay. Verse 1, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ. Start with that phrase right there. There's an interesting thing going on right in that phrase, is that the word Simon actually in the original was Simeon. Well, that's the Jewish spelling of Simon. I have no idea why Peter did that. Maybe he was addressing a Jewish audience. I don't know if anybody even called him Simeon anymore, except his mom, if she was still around. But that was his Jewish name. But we always know him as Simon because it always gets translated into the Greek. But originally it was Simeon. Now, in some of the manuscripts, it got changed to Simon, but that's because I think, remember, they had to copy everything by hand back then, no printing presses, copying machines. And I think the scribes would think they were correcting a misspelling. It's not supposed to be Simeon, it's Simon. But it was originally Simeon. And what's ironic about that, that gives more proof it was written by Peter. If it was an imposter, it would have never occurred to an imposter to use the name Simeon. People probably didn't even know that was his original name. So it's Simeon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, I like to put myself sometimes in the shoes of the first century Christians. You know, they probably met in homes in a lot of towns, small. If they had money, I suppose they would either rent a building or build a building, not unlike we do today. So you'd have a congregation. And what I like to imagine, if an early first century church, they're meeting together, they're worshiping, they're singing, they're praising God, they wouldn't have a whole New Testament yet. Maybe they were really fortunate and they had a few copies of some of Paul's letters. I bet they got read and reread and studied and taken care of because they were valuable. You had to copy them by hand. And if they had somebody in the church who could do copies, I'm sure they were making copies for themselves. So all that stuff's going on in the churches. What I like to imagine, what if there's a church service going on and a new person walks in? Maybe they don't recognize him right away. He introduces himself and he says, "Hi, I'm Simon Peter." Wow. What would happen in that church? I think the first thing would be, "You're Simon Peter? You actually saw the Lord. You walked with him. You were on the Mount of Transfiguration. You were there at the end of his life, the last days. You talked to him then. You saw the empty tomb. You saw him after he wrote." They'd probably be ready to build an altar and touch him and put him up there. But here's Simon Peter. What's the first thing he says? He says, "But I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. I'm a slave of Jesus Christ." And back then, if you were a servant or a slave, it was a full-time job. It was 24/7. You were usually part of a household because usually rich people didn't live alone. They had a household, and these slaves were part of a household. If they were fortunate, they had a good master who treated them well. That wasn't always guaranteed. They were property. They could be sold and traded like other property. But that was his attitude that he had to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was his master, and Peter was on call 24/7. I think the order is on purpose here. A servant and apostle. Servant first, apostle second. But he was an apostle. He held that office. He actually walked with Jesus Christ. He was one of the 12. And the rest of the verse goes on, "To those who, through the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, have received the faith as precious as ours." A lot of theology in one little sentence there. It talks about the righteousness of God. It talks about our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, being one person, the Trinity. Receiving faith, it talks about faith. That's all in this one phrase here. And there's three things I want to say about this phrase. First of all, it says faith is something received. And to receive something, there has to be a giver. And who's the giver? That's God. We receive our faith from God. Number two, and it's received through God's righteousness. Or it says the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. So I should correct that. It's the righteousness of Jesus Christ it's talking about. Well, he's God, but it's talking about the second person of the Trinity right now. Righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's how the faith is received, is through him. And number three, the faith is doled out on an equal scale. Now, you might not see that right away if you're reading the NIV. Somehow they managed to kind of smooth that over. If you have another version, it might jump out about the equal status. I'm going to paraphrase the NIV a little bit here and say, to those through the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, have received a faith as precious as and on equal status as ours. That's another, I think that's Peter again being manifesting his humility. He says, I'm an apostle, but your faith, your grace, your salvation, your righteousness, all that is on equal status with me. There's no pecking order here. It's all equal. That's what Peter's saying. Now I'm going to drop down to verse 3. Verse 3 says, His divine power has given us His divine power, and that's the power of His resurrection, as in Philippians 3:10. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. So we're equipped by divine power is what that's saying. And I think one thing Peter's trying to bring out here is we're equipped by divine power, but this divine power, we're not ignorant of it. We know who our enabler is. It is He. It is our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gives us this divine power, who called us. You know, He called us. We know who called us, Jesus Christ. Not some indefinite, undefined spiritual force like the Force in Star Wars or something like that. It's a person. We know who it is. It's Jesus Christ Himself. It's not some great hoo-ha in the sky. It's very definite. And I think Peter's doing this on purpose, making sure we understand this because of the argument that's going to be coming on with the false teachers that have been penetrating the churches that he's addressing here. So this knowledge, this definite knowledge of God and Jesus Christ, we're going to see how important it is to Peter's argument. As followers of Christ, we know by whom we are called, and we know Him by His glory and virtue. That's what it says at the end of the verse, His glory and His virtue. We are called by a person, not by an idea, not by an abstraction, not by some vision that we don't know where it came from. It's a real person who came in the flesh and dwelt among us, John 1:14. So that's very real. Verse 4. Through these, He has given us His very great and precious promises so that through them, meaning the promises, you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. So for Peter, the promises of God are strong motivators, motivators for participating in the divine nature and escaping the corrupt world. I think this is teaching us that escapism is very underrated. It's actually a good thing if it's done in the biblical way, is what he's telling us here. We can reduce the troubles of this world by focusing on the promises of God. Where do you find the promises of God? You find the promises of God in His Word. So spending time in the Word, in the Bible. If you haven't been spending time in the Bible, ask somebody who knows, where are the promises? I want to start with those. That is a great place to start. Where are the promises of God in the Bible? They're all through it, but there's some passages that maybe you could be pointed to. Because it will bring a lot of relief. It really does. And that's Peter's purpose here, pointing that out. So you can escape the corrupt world through those promises. When you focus on God's promises, the corrupt world becomes much smaller. It becomes small potatoes. Not big potatoes, small potatoes. Well, that's the first four verses. Now I want to move into the heresy that Peter was addressing. Now, I move into this with trepidation, with a little bit of fear, because those of you who've never heard of these things, it might be a little bit like, wow. But anytime you start talking about anything with an ism at the end, and what we're going to talk about is Gnosticism. You know, Gnosticism. It has an ism at the end, Anytime you talk about something with an ism at the end, usually the first time you hear about it, you're not going to get it. It takes a few times because it's more like a puzzle. You know, if I can give you a couple pieces of it, but until they fit together, those individual pieces don't make a lot of sense. You know, he's just up there talking nonsense. Hopefully I'm not. Hopefully. but I want to give an overview here. And as we move through Peter in the next couple weeks, you know, we'll talk about these things more, and I think they will start, some of these will start fitting together. First thing I want to talk about is the word knowledge. It shows up a lot in the book of 2 Peter, in the letter. It's used 12 times in 2 Peter and 5 times in the passage we just went over today, the word knowledge. So it's important, I believe, to Peter, or understanding 2 Peter, because he was dealing with a heresy that is centered around knowledge, but improper knowledge, wrong knowledge, and we'll talk about that. I believe what he was dealing with was the very first, very early instances of the Gnostic heresy or Gnosticism. And I'll talk about what Gnosticism is in 25 words or less, hopefully. Now, those of you, maybe there's some of you who know some church history, and you say, well, this is the first century. You know, he probably wrote this around 67, 68, 69 AD, or around there. I forget if Steve gave a year or not. But it's in that era, before the fall of Jerusalem. And some people who know church history, I say, well, Gnosticism wasn't around yet. Well, I want to be clear, this is, you could say, proto-Gnosticism. It was the first, it was just, you know, the first seeds were being planted and the roots were just starting to grow and the plant was just starting to come up. 100 years later, it was out there. It was all formalized. The Gnostics were writing books and they were teaching people, and they were mostly trying to steal people from Christianity or getting into their churches and infesting them with Gnostic ideas. That's sort of the way Gnosticism works. And Peter, probably under, you know, with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, was able to just spot it really early. He says, wow, this is starting to get into the church, and it's going to create big problems. Now, I believe the Gnostic problem that did end up in the church would have probably been far greater if Peter hadn't been on the scene and God hadn't inspired him to write this, because people were already then aware of this coming. So what is Gnosticism? I've been talking about it. I haven't even said what it is. Well, the word gnosis simply means knowledge. So if you have gnosis of fixing a car, that just simply means you know how to fix a car. It's knowledge. That's all gnosis means, and that's what the word Gnostic and Gnosticism all comes from, the word gnosis. So a Gnostic is someone who has knowledge. So if I know how to fix a car, I'm a Gnostic in fixing a car. I know how to do it. I have knowledge. But then you put an ism at the end of it, and it kind of changes everything, right? It always changes everything when you put the ism at the end of a word, because a Gnosticism is either a philosophy or a religion, right? If you have an ism at the end, it's philosophy or religion usually. Well, Gnosticism was a religion, is a religion. It's still out there. It's still here today, that claims that knowledge will save you from the evil, corrupt world. Somebody might, when they first hear that, well, that doesn't sound that bad. Well, note what's doing the saving. Knowledge saves you from an evil, corrupt world. So Gnosticism is a religion that claims that knowledge will save you from an evil, corrupt world. Now, there's a lot of stuff written about Gnosticism, books, and, you know, there's probably professors who specialize in it in some universities in that. But they all agree on this point that I just said here. Even the big, thick books agree with this, that it's that knowledge will save you from an evil, corrupt world. So if you get that much out of it, you're on a good start. But it's not just any old knowledge. You know, knowledge of knowing how to fix a car, that's not going to save you. It's a little more precise than that. This knowledge will come in the form of a special revelation. It's kind of secret. That was another thing with Gnosticism. The knowledge always had this mystery about it, this secretive stuff about it. And this knowledge, it was knowledge usually of the spiritual world and of the physical world. It was of both, but a lot of information about the spiritual world, and a lot, it give you knowledge about yourself and your relationship to this spiritual world and this relationship to the physical world. You'd get this special knowledge. And then that would give you insight how to live your life, and essentially you would be a saved person. You would be a Gnostic. That actually became a technical term. You know, I'm a Gnostic. Oh, I am too. Hey, we're Gnostic brothers or whatever they called each other. And also it's important to realize that you knew things that non-Gnostics could not possibly know. It was a kind of an elite thing. If you were a Gnostic, you were part of the club. Not everybody was a Gnostic. Not everybody was chosen to be a Gnostic. Some were and some weren't. Now let me give you a couple characteristics of Gnosticism that might give you hopefully a little bit more insight of what it's about. Well, one thing is knowledge came before faith. Now think about that if you're a Christian. Knowledge came before faith. You had to know certain things before you could be a Gnostic. Well, what's Christianity? By grace you're saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. So it stands in pretty stark contrast to Christianity. That's backwards. Knowledge is fine, you know, when you're a Christian. Yeah, go out and study the Bible or study science or whatever, but do it, you know, but your faith comes first. Here it was the other way around. Your knowledge came first in Gnosticism. You had to have that knowledge or you were nowhere, according to Gnosticism. So if you were a Christian Gnostic, and this is very important too, did Jesus save you? No. Knowledge saved you. See, this is the teaching that was getting into the church in Peter's day. Jesus didn't even do the saving. Knowledge did the saving. And, it depended. There was a lot of different Gnostic cults, but most of the Christian Gnostics would say, well, Jesus was a messenger who delivered, he was delivering this knowledge from the great hoo-ha in the sky or whatever, their God. You couldn't know their God. It was so far out there in Gnosticism, you couldn't know the first thing about God. There was lesser gods. See, the God, the perfect God was way out there, and the perfect God created a lesser God, until you finally got to earth, and each God would be more corrupt, less perfect, or however you want to put it. And by the time you got to earth, the creator of earth was a pretty corrupt God, and that's why there's evil in the world. Now, that might sound like nonsense to you. I don't know. It didn't sound like nonsense to the Gnostics back in that day. For some reason, it had an appeal, and there's still people who believe that today. But anyway, that explained evil in the world. But Jesus didn't save you from that evil. Knowledge did. So what did Jesus do? He just delivered the knowledge. Well, what did Jesus do after you delivered the knowledge? It didn't matter. There was no sanctification. There was no nothing. He could just go fly a kite. Jesus was useless after he delivered the knowledge. It really turned Christianity on its ear if these teachings were starting to be believed by people. Jesus wasn't really Jesus. He didn't even have to be a human being. In fact, in most Gnostic literature, he wasn't. He was like an angel who flew down and delivered knowledge. Or he could have been a human. See, it didn't matter. All these things didn't matter. All that mattered was that you got that knowledge. And so what about the Bible? What good was the Bible? Well, all you have to do, I don't know if there's any in the libraries around here, but if you can find any ancient Gnostic literature, read it. Christian Gnostic literature, it's just, they take the Bible and make nonsense out of it. It's like it's a plaything. They added to it, they subtracted to it, and it never mattered. There was no real, they didn't really care about having a canon because all that mattered was getting that knowledge. In fact, I had an assignment from a teacher once. I had to read a, it was just a short document, but it was translated out of an original Gnostic document that came out of Egypt. Egypt became a hotbed of Gnosticism in ancient times. And it was called the Second Treatise of the Great Seth. Seth, the character Seth in the Bible, was often the messenger. It wasn't even always Jesus. You know, they could pick any character out of the Bible. It really didn't matter. So the title of it was the Second Treatise of the Great Seth, but Seth wasn't even in the rest of it. It was Jesus who was the deliverer. I guess it was supposed to be written by Seth. I don't know. But it was just nonsense. Jesus was coming and going and doing all kinds of weird things, but he delivered the knowledge from that God that no one could know. So anyway, what appealed about all this? Well, one thing that appealed about it was that it was the promise of spiritual power. You get that knowledge and you became more powerful. You know, power is always something that's tempting. And one wonders whether the spiritual power, because you had secret knowledge, you felt more powerful, or was there really a satanic influence here? Kind of a hard thing to answer, but it could be either way, or both. Another appeal, the doctrine, remember I said that creation is evil? That we are created by a lesser God, an evil God, not the perfect God. That means that the material world, including your own body, is bad and evil. And you'll see this in 2 Peter. Peter addresses this. People considered their own body to be evil, so it didn't matter what you did with it. And he talks about we'll get to that in a couple weeks, of all these immoral things that resulted out of that. Personal morality goes right out the window, is what happens. Some modern examples. I said that it's still around. And one example of full-known Gnosticism, there's a church called Ecclesia Gnostica. One thing I didn't mention, Ecclesia Gnostica is a church, that's a Gnostic church, that's what the word means, is Gnostic church, Ecclesia Gnostica. They're big in Eastern Europe. Gnosticism's more popular over there. And in the Balkans, there's a lot of Gnostics and Gnostic churches in that. They totally steal everything from the Eastern Orthodox Church. They even they look like Pope hats and wear those white robes. And it looks like a Greek Orthodox service, but it's a Gnostic service. And what I found scary, I listened to a tape of a sermon talking about the grace of God and talking about Jesus Christ, and you'd think it was a Christian sermon until he really got into it, and wow, you know, it's not at all. Not at all. Jesus doesn't save in the way they look at things. Now, we're mostly more familiar here in America, though Ecclesia Gnostica does have congregations in the United States, and there's other Gnostic churches. That's just an example I'm using. That's full-blown Gnosticism, which is... we couldn't get into that now. That'd take a long time. But some things we are familiar with, where Gnosticism kind of raises its head. And any group where they're marked by levels of knowledge, a couple examples of that might be Freemasonry. The more you know, you reach higher levels. Supposedly you have more... insight into the spiritual world, and another example would be Scientology. I paid a quarter. I was just curious. I didn't know what, you know. It was in the news with all the celebrities and that doing it, and then I saw the book Dianetics at a library sale. They were selling it for a quarter. I want my money back, but they won't give it. I did read it first, probably the first third I read in detail, then I skimmed the rest. It was getting kind of redundant. But that's levels. You work your way up the ladder until you become Tom Cruise or something. I wasn't quite sure how that worked. But it's a form of Gnosticism. And both Freemasonry and Scientology sort of, they play down the evil of the world. Evil isn't all that bad. It's either all in your mind or it doesn't matter. And so morality really goes out the window. Mormonism has a lot of these traits where you can work up to be some kind of demigod. The New Age movement, there's a lot of cults within that that have that. And here's some examples that you might run into sometimes. I don't even know if I spelled it right in my notes, but the Kabbalah, which is somehow connected with the Old Testament Jewish, and it's been in the news because that singer and moral paragon, Madonna, I think, is part of the Kabbalah movement now, so it made the news. But where it's Gnostic is they claim through numerology and that to get new meanings out of the Old Testament that weren't there before. And if you've ever seen these kind of books on shelves or secret codes of the Bible and things like that, well, those are Gnostic-based. It's saying, you know, you learn this secret stuff and your behavior doesn't matter anymore. It's knowing is what really counts, knowing this secret stuff. Another area you run into it, and probably I wouldn't even thought of this except, you know, the last few years with the movies and books that have been coming out, like the Da Vinci Code, these grand conspiracy theories. Some of those, not all of them, but some of those are Gnostic-based. You know, if you understand what's going on there, you are saved by your knowledge. So Gnosticism is alive and well. In a religion or cult does not have to be full-blown Gnosticism to be Gnostic. A lot of them today are not full-blown, though they do exist. And just incidentally, in 2 Peter, just in the part we read, you know, it says, through the knowledge of God, through our knowledge of Him, to make every effort to add faith, to faith goodness, to faith knowledge, same word. And in 1:8, keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So in a biblical world, and this is both in the Old Testament and the New Testament, knowledge of God always assumed a relationship with Him. To know God meant to have a relationship. Either a personal relationship or a covenant relationship, but there was always a relationship with God. He was never the great hoo-ha in the sky that no one knew anything about. He was right there. And that's key, and that's what Peter is bringing out. It was never knowledge about someone you did not know. And also in the Bible, our body is never evil, only fallen. And there's future glorification. So, Peter understood the Greek culture he lived in. See, one thing Peter and Paul used to do, they used to debate all the time with non-Christians and that, so they knew the philosophies. You can't do that all the time and not learn what's going on in the culture around them. But Peter is talking about us knowing God in a faith sense and in a relationship sense in these passages, that a person has first of all, through God's righteousness, in verse 1, received a faith. Secondly, through divine power, he's received everything else he needs for life and godliness. In verse 3, and is willing to participate in the divine nature. That's the believers willing to participate in the divine nature. That's in verse 4, rather. But that's where Peter is heading with this concept of knowledge, as opposed to the false teachers. Now, as we go through 2 Peter in the next few weeks, we'll see that the false teachers that Peter was combating One thing they were teaching was compromise with the world. That's nothing new. Compromise with the world. We run into that all the time in the church. Now, the brand of compromise Peter was dealing with, we will see next week, well, in the next couple weeks, that it was particularly hideous and dangerous. Imagine a so-called believer who could involve him or herself in a sensual or sexual sin on an ongoing basis and still claim and insist they were a Christian. You know, very dangerous stuff there. That was Peter's fear for the church that he loved. And he's laying a foundation here for his argument. And Pastor Steve's going to come back up here and talk about one of the huge building blocks in that argument, and that's the security of the believer.
Thank you.
I think that applause was for you, Jim. I thought you were a little obnoxious, but that was just me. Thank you. I want to talk about making our calling and election sure. Because as Jim said, this is a big building block in Peter's defense against these false teachers. Now, the race we run, Paul talks about running the race, how the Christian life is a race. And we've all heard this, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Jim and I were playing with different analogies to yesterday about what it's like trying to live the Christian life in a world that's going in the opposite direction. And I came up with this analogy. I like it. The race we run is a marathon, not a sprint, but it's an uphill marathon run backwards on an escalator. If you stand still, you go downhill fast. So how do we make our calling and election sure? Well, before I can answer the how question, I have to go back to the W's. Who, when, what, where, and why. So in verse 10, chapter 1, verse 10, we'll get back to the scripture. I'll tell Pastor Dave tomorrow. Yeah, Jim talked about some other stuff, and then I took us back to the scripture. He'll pat me on the back. That'll be good, even though that was the plan all along. I'll exaggerate. Verse 10. Therefore, my brothers, that's who? The people he's addressing is who? That's us. Because if you look back at verse 1, it says everybody. You got a Bible here? Let me see this, brother. Okay. Gosh, can you read that small print? Oh, you're not on the same chapter I'm on. Ha-ha, gotcha. No, I'm just teasing. It says, Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. Raise your hand if that includes you. Yeah, yeah. So who's he writing to? He's writing to us. Then it says, be all the more eager. Okay? That answers the when question. If you're eager, when are you going to do it? You're going to do it now. When? To make your calling and election sure. That's the what. And I'll get back to telling you more about your calling and election. But now we're in verse 5. For this reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. So how do we make our calling and election sure? Well, it says make every effort. That implies that it's something we do. Okay? Now don't stop listening. I still believe in grace. But the fact that we're making an effort to add something to our faith means there's something we should do. We can't do it if we don't begin with faith. What is faith? Well, the scripture says in Hebrews 11:1, we're pretty sure we know this. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. So faith is being sure and certain of what we do not see. And in Ephesians 2:8, Paul writes, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." So we know what faith is. It's being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we can't see, and it's a gift from God. It's not something we gin up. It's not something that if we know enough, we add to our knowledge faith. We have to begin with faith, and that's a gift from God. But having begun with faith, Peter says we're to add to our faith goodness. Okay? And goodness is kind of a wimpy translation of the Greek word, which is arete or arete. And it was actually kind of a slogan that they used when they were marching into battle. It was excellence. Okay? A better translation would be moral excellence. So add to your faith moral excellence. Okay? If you ain't being good, you haven't added to your faith. You haven't lost your faith. But Peter says, okay, you want to make your calling sure? Add to your faith moral excellence. And then add to your moral excellence knowledge. And this is that word, gnosis, from which Gnosticism comes, something you know. Okay? So again, as Jim said, it's not a starting point. It's useless if we don't begin with faith. And the only way we can add moral excellence is by faith. We can't do it. If we try to do it on our own, we can't do it. It's only by the grace of God that we can do that, but it's something we should do, not something we should ignore. We add knowledge. And then to our knowledge, we add self-control. Now, self-control is a fruit of the Spirit. Just like faith is a fruit of the Spirit, they're a gift from God. But we need to add to our knowledge. If we know what we're supposed to do, it still takes self-control to do it. If we just have knowledge, we can still, as we've all experienced, fall into sin. We need self-control. And then we need perseverance. I've said it 5 times tonight, and I've pronounced it that way every time. My friends make fun of me because I say perseverance instead of perseverance. Don't ask me why. But I said it right 5 times in a row, so you should be pleased. I think that's the Wisconsin way. I probably say it the California way. Okay. No? Gary says no. What is perseverance? Oh, that's 6. The characteristic of a man who is not swerved from his deliberate purpose and his loyalty to faith and piety by even the greatest trials and sufferings. Not swerving from your faith, no matter what happens, because we will face trials, we will go through sufferings. Not swerving, that's perseverance. 7. Godliness. You know what godliness is? Just what it sounds like. Being like Jesus Christ. Okay? We can't do that on our own. But if we begin with faith and we continue by faith to grow in grace, to add goodness, moral excellence, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, 8. It will be easier to add godliness to our character. And to godliness, we add brotherly kindness. Hey, that answers the where question. Where should we do this? Make our calling and election sure? The answer is right there in brotherly kindness, Philadelphia. That's the Greek word. So we know where, Philadelphia. What does that mean? It doesn't mean some city in Pennsylvania. What it means is, number one, in the company of our brothers and sisters, where we are. See, the problem with my analogy about the Christian race being a marathon run up a down elevator is that that sounds like we're doing it alone. Maybe it's more like, you know, what's the bicycle race? The French Tour de France. Thank you. Thank you. It's like riding the Tour de France up a down escalator. We got people with us. Okay? And that's where we're supposed to do it. In fellowship. Where we are. Finally, add to your brotherly kindness love. Okay? Those are the Greek words for love. Philadelphia. And finally, agape love. The God-like love for one another. So how do we do? How do we persevere? How do we make our election and calling sure? We keep adding to our faith. We keep growing. We keep running the race with all those things. Perseverance, knowledge, brotherly kindness, and love. Why? Why should we do this? Verse 8. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you see that word knowledge? He's setting the table to talk about these false teachings that are coming in. There is a true knowledge. And we need to have these qualities. They need to be increasing. It says, if you possess these qualities in increasing measure. You got brotherly kindness? It's supposed to be increasing. Okay? If you stand still, boom, you go down the escalator. They need to increase. Then they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive. Okay? In the New American Standard Version, which is a literal, more literal translation, it says, neither useless nor unfruitful. Notice the double negative. Okay. Well, useless, you know what that implies in Greek? It implies that we're lazy. Lazy. We just won't do anything. We stay in bed. And unfruitful. It says if we possess these qualities in increasing measure, they'll keep us from being lazy and unfruitful. And the double negative, neither useless nor unfruitful, emphasizes that without these qualities, we will be useless and unfruitful. Okay? We'll still have our faith. If we don't add these other things, we'll be useless, lazy, and unfruitful. And then when it says knowledge in your Lord Jesus Christ, this is a different word. This is not gnosis. It's epinosis. So what? That means true knowledge. It means precise and correct knowledge. Okay? In contrast to Gnosticism, if you have knowledge that isn't true, you're not wise, you're a fool. Right? All that knowledge, if it's not true, it's pretty useless. Verse 9, but if anyone doesn't have them, he's nearsighted and blind and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. Forgotten. See, this is really important. If we do not possess these qualities in increasing measure, we're not in danger of losing our salvation, but we are in danger of doubting it. And that's the way the enemy gets us. Verse 10. Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall. And you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Okay, we're supposed to be eager. Again, that means we're going to do it now. To make your calling and election sure. What's the difference between an election and a calling? Well, it's not like politics, okay? I have a calling to be president of the United States, but I've never been elected. It's actually just the opposite of that. We were elected to be the children of God from the beginning of time. We're the elect. Calling is here and now. Carrying out that life as the children of God. God knew that we would be saved. Sure. Making it sure. It's not that we're in danger of losing it, but we're in danger of forgetting it. Forgetting that our sins are forgiven. Or that they needed to be forgiven. Either way, the enemy's got us in a trap. If you do these things, you will never fall. Okay? Now, really, that means stumble. Let's get back on the escalator. You've got to keep running. You've got to keep moving. Otherwise, you'll go downhill fast if you're running up an escalator, right? Okay? What happens if you fall? You're going down, right? You're going down. You get to the bottom, and because it flattens out, you kind of stay there, except that every time a step comes up, it hits you in the jaw. Boom, 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 boom. And that's what it is when you're lost in sin, when you are backslidden, okay? You're backslidden. You're sitting at the bottom of that escalator, and it's hitting you in the face. But if you do these things, you will never fall. You won't stumble. And you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Rich welcome. Okay, when I think rich welcome into his kingdom, I think of Matthew 25, 23, where it talks about the master says, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful." And again, later in chapter 25, he says, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of this world." Okay? So if we do these things, we won't stumble and we will receive a rich welcome. Now, it implies that if we don't do these things, we will stumble and we won't receive a rich welcome. And yet, the other thing I think of when I think of a rich welcome, I think of the prodigal son. He stumbled. He sat there, he got to the bottom of the escalator, and he kept banging his head on that step coming up, and it was covered in pig manure. Besides, he stumbled. But when he came back to his father, he did receive a rich welcome, didn't he? There's always that for us if we turn to him. So what do we want to do? We want to add to our faith moral excellence, and add to that knowledge, and add self-control. Finally, we add love, God-like love. And if we possess these qualities in an increasing measure, in other words, we don't stop, then we won't fall, and we'll receive a rich welcome. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. And we thank you for the assurance we have, Lord God, that we are your people, saved by grace through faith. Lord, I pray that we would be among those who persevere in our pursuit of you, that we might become more Christ-like, more full of your love. Help us even this night, in Jesus' name. Amen.